crisis and a scientific acuity. The first speaker is Professor Remy Abkar from Switzerland, and actually University of Jewish. And Professor Abkar is a former student of Eco Normal Superior Design School and at his PhD, the title of his thesis, Numerical Simulation on Meteorological Problem. He has been an engineer at WONERA, N-O-N-E-R-A, and then it's a French aerospace lab, and then a research scientist at INRIA, I-N-R-I-A, until 1996. He was a professor at the University of Bordeaux until December 2013, when he moved to University of Jewish. He's on editorial board for several journals, including Journal of Computational Physics, Journal of Scientific Computing, and Mathematics of Computation. He has been awarded an advanced research grant from ERC. He's interested in numerical approximation of upper body problems and using unstructured meshes and high order schemes that are more efficient on modern computers. And application of his work including fluid mechanics, single and multi-phase flows, interface problem, Eulerian and Lagrange hydrodynamics, and Hamilton-Jacobi equation, and more recently is working on meshing problems. And his title of the lectures are classes of high-order schemes for hyperbolic problems. Please.
Oops, thank you. Can you hear me? Mm-hmm. Thank you very much for this. Mm-hmm. No? Okay. So thank you very much for this introduction, and I would like also to thank the committee who selected me. I was very surprised. When I received the mail, I thought it was a spam. And thanks to Google, I didn't throw it away because I checked that the guy who was signing was a real man. Okay, so I'm trying to explain a little bit of this class of method. I've been working with several people since a couple of years. So this is a very classical problem, in fact, which has been dealt with many people since many years, is how to compute this kind of flows or more general flows with a more physical equation of states or MHD problem, etc. Where on general meshes like this one, so it's another problem with hybrid meshes, 2D, 3D, etc. Without any tuning parameter, and basically you can easily go from first to n order of accuracy. And the talk after me will also consider the same problem with a different method. So including inviscid or turbulent effects. So for example, in this case, so it's a scramjet problem. You have many shock waves with interaction, etc. Very complicated interaction. And there is absolutely no tuning parameter. And the way it is coded is exactly the way I'm going to present, except that I'm talking about scalar problems. But so the problem is the following. So you have the unsteady Navier-Stokes equation with a source term, which can be seen sort of as a turbulent model. And the technique is that we are developing emphasis on the structure of the operator. So here you have a divergence operator, which is intrinsic, is a trace of the gradient. You have symmetries, you may have equilibrium. For example, this is why I'm putting the source term on the, I never know where my left and my right, on this side of the equality and not on the other side of the equality. Because I look at the operator as a whole and not as with a splitting technique. So we are looking for methods which are easy to implement. So it means that we have very local structure, both in the physical space and also in the computer space, so memory-wise, which means compact stencil, like in DG technique, and it's truly high order. I would explain what I mean by this. Stable and parameter-free, including for strong shocks like in this problem, for example. So this is a joint work with many people at INRIA, Bordeaux, VKI, and Michigan also. And there is also an issue about meshing. If you do high order on complex bodies, if you don't fit the mesh correctly, then you spend a lot of energy to increase the accuracy that you waste immediately because you are not considering the boundary correctly. So I'm not going to talk about this, but I'm trying to connect this technique to existing one, and emphasis on conservation and accuracy issues. Then I will present this, and now by duality, if I can say, I will show also that these schemes can be seen as a finite volume scheme. Give one application and a good conclusion. So the problem, so I'm going to focus only on scalar problem because it's complicated enough. So you have, and I will totally skip the viscous effect, which is a little bit tricky. So I'm focusing only on the purely hyperbolic problem, and moreover in the steady problem. So I will not consider time stepping, even though this has been done with Mario Ricciuto, for example. And so you have this problem on this type of mesh. And in general, you have a triangulation with triangle or quads or eggs or tets or pyramid, etc. Then you have a node, so the degrees of freedom, which can be seen as either the approximation of the solution at the degrees of freedom, for example, for continuous finite elements. They can be seen as a moment of the solution or other thing for DG, for example. So I'm going to focus on continuous finite element class method. So that there are many, many ways of approximating this. For example, if you consider continuous finite element, so you have the SUPG technique, where here the space is made of continuous element, which is globally, continuous function, which are globally continuous. And on each element, which are simply so, you assume that you have a polynomial of degree k, and for simplicity, not for simplicity, but in this case, k is fixed. So if you apply the Galerkin technique, so the black term, you know that it's totally unstable, so you need to stabilize, and SUPG is this type of stabilization. So it's a streamlined diffusion, because here you have a symmetry in the operator, tau is a scalar which is positive, and the cooking recipe of the method is how to choose this parameter. But basically, this is the spirit. So V is a test function, and U super H is a solution. There are other techniques, more recent by Burman, for example, instead of stabilizing in elements, they stabilize across edges, and they introduce this this term. So it's basically something which has a dimension of the gradient of the flux multiplied by the product of the jump of the test and the trial function, multiplied by h squared for dimensional issue, like here you have h for the same reason, and gamma, a parameter like the tau parameter. Now, of course, when you want to implement this, you are not going to do this, so you are choosing a special function, so here the Lagrange basis function, and using the fact that the support of this function is constant, is compact, then you have a finite sum, and this is what you get in both cases. And the remark, which is totally trivial, is now if you consider, so here it's the sum over the element which share the degree of freedom sigma on which you are trying to do approximation. So now you consider this quantity or that quantity, it's the same type of sum, call it phi sigma k, and now instead of taking the sum over the element which shares this degree of freedom, now you consider one element, and then you sum all this quantity over for all the degrees of freedom on this element. And of course, many things simplify, and this sum is just the integral over the boundary of the normal flux. And the reason for this is that because you are using a Lagrange finite element, the sum of the basis function is 1, so it means that the sum of the gradient is 0. So this term and that term simplify, and here you get a 1. And of course, it works the same for the jump stabilization technique for the same reason, and you get this. It's a totally trivial remark, but it's in fact you can do a lot with this trivial remark. Now, if you do a discontinuous finite element, it's the same. Of course, the trial space and the test function space are different. Now you want a low possible discontinuity, and the method is the following, and the probes is the choice of the flux. And for example, it's very well known that if you have this scheme, so, then you have entropy stability. And now, if you want to implement this, of course, you use special the test function which are associated to the Lagrange, for example, the Lagrange basis function, and you get this. And again, if you call this quantity phi sigma k, now you specialize for one element, you consider the sum over all the degrees of freedom on this element of this quantity, and what you get for the same reason is the sum over the elements of the normal flux. Now, if you do finite volume, in fact, you can get the same. So the first thing to do is to show that you can rephrase the finite volume formulation in a way which looks like what I've done before. So here I consider this, so my degrees of freedom are the vertices. I have one series of elements, so here it's triangle, but it could be a more general element. And I decide to consider this control volume, which is using the centroid and the midpoint of the edges. Could be more general control volume or different control volume. And the technique is to sum over all the edges which share the degree of freedom I of the flux going through this edge and that edge. So in my notation, I have nij plus for this normal, which is on the top of the edge ilj, so this is why there is a plus, and the one which is on the bottom, there is a minus. And by simple, you rephrase you change the sum, instead of summing over the edges, then you sum over the elements which share this degree of freedom, you have exactly the same formula. And then, because this is a closed loop, then you can subtract zero, and zero here is the flux at this point. It is again the sum of the normals, which is zero because it's a closed loop. And then you call this phi I, phi sigma k, as before. And what you see is that first the scheme here is now the sum over the element which shares this degree of freedom of this quantity, that I'm going to call a residual. And this residual are this complex formula, but what it means is that you take the normal flux across these edges plus the normal flux across that edges, and you subtract the normal flux across the part of this boundary. And this is exactly this. And when you consider these three residual, which are written here, you sum, and what you get is again the integral over the boundary of the normal flux of something, and the something is the P1 interpolation of the flux, and that's it. So in all these cases, you can rephrase all known schemes, all the schemes I know, as the sum over the elements for any degree of freedom, the sum over elements which share this degree of freedom of quantities, which has basically the dimension of the difference of the flux, and this will be zero. And they all satisfy this type of conservation relation. So you take any, you pick any element, you consider the sum over all the degrees of freedom in this element of this residual, and they will be, they will sum to the integral over the boundary of the normal flux. So if you have continuous finite elements, by consistency, this is exactly the flux at on the boundary. If you have a numerical flux, which means that the two states are different, like in DG, then it's going this formula. But all these techniques sum up on this. And the idea is how to design a scheme which satisfy this kind of principle, and which has you can rise up as much as you want the accuracy, you have non-oscillatory properties, etc., etc. And the answer is yes. And before trying to answer this question, I just want to make a small remark, again very trivial, but not so well known. And to show this, I take the example of SUPG, but it could be the same for DG and also when you do jump stabilization. So assume you have an exact solution of your problem, which is smooth enough. So you satisfy div of f equals 0 pointwise, because it's smooth enough. So you interpolate this. So by interpolant, you have this equality, because you are using a polynomial of order r. And if you denote by the delta f the difference of the exact flux minus the flux at the interpolant, and you consider this quantity, which is the residual for the SUPG scheme. You have the central part, the flux of the term on the boundary, and the stabilization part. Because you have div of f pointwise for the exact solution, you can subtract zero. And zero is this formula where you have applied, you have replaced u sub h by u exact. So in fact, this quantity is equal to this one. And now you just use the standard properties of interpolation and look at the scale of each of the term. And for example, this one, which is the simplest, phi is of the order of 1. Delta f, if f is C1, say, is of the order of h to the k plus 1. So this is basically 1 times h to the k plus 1 multiplied by the size of the perimeter or the area of the boundary. And if the mesh is well behaved, this is basically h to the d minus 1. And you can do the same reasoning for each of the terms, and each of the terms scales the same, and the remark is that this is nothing more than the h to the k plus d. And in fact, this is a trivial remark, but which is also true for stabilization with jump, true for DG, but very likely violated when you apply limiting because you have the exponent problem. It's wrong in general for finite volume, or if it's true, it's difficult to achieve because you have a very large stencil. And as I'm going to show, that it's this stupid remark is can be seen as the basis of a systematic analysis of truncation error. So what I want to do is to to take the dual point of view. So you want to construct schemes which look like this. So there will be this is a conservation relation. So there is a mistake here. The sum of the residual has to be the integral over the normal of the normal flux from the boundary. They should scale like this. At least when you replace the u sub h by some interpolant of the exact solution. And you want to have stability and homosymmetry property. And this is what I'm going to explain. In fact, this kind of scheme have a very long history. The first paper was given by Nie in an IR conference in 1981. He was an engineer at Bombardier. And it was just a reformulation of the Lax-Vandroff method in 2D for using multi-grid in a very simple way. So there is Philroe, of course. In fact, this paper is a raw scheme. It's not a finite volume paper, but it's a residual description paper because it was really thinking this framework. There will be work by De Koninck, Nishikawa, Karaini, etc. And this has very strong connection with the stabilized finite method. And my aim is to show how to combine ideas coming from finite volume schemes, non-oscillatory, and infinity stability, upwinding if possible, and also a little bit of finite difference, and which are very, very simple to implement. Of course, it's a matter of states, I know, but you have no fancy limiter, no Riemann solver, or if you want to have Riemann solver, you can put Riemann solver, but it's really not necessary. You have compact stencil and no tunable parameter. And the advantage, but also the problem of this technique, is that everything is seen from a purely discrete point of view, like finite difference. So there is no natural variation of formulation, and it's really, you need to really understand what you do to do something clever. So again, my problem is the same. So I will consider triangulation of my computational domain. The unknown of the vertices will be approximation of the function at the degrees of freedom. So which means that I have in my mind, I'm going to do Picquet-Lagrange interpolation, even though you can do more general things. And U sub H will be nothing more than this kind of thing. So it's a globally continuous approximation using Lagrange approximation. So in a nutshell, the scheme will be coded as like a finite element method. So you make a loop over the elements. For each element, you first start to compute the integral of the normal flux, which means that you are going to use some quadrature formula, and this is the last point where you are going to use the quadrature formula. Then you distribute according to this conservation property, and all the technique is contained in this formula. And the residual, again, has to be understood as the difference of flux. And then you gather, which means that for every degree of freedom, you will try to enforce this relation. So the sum over the element which shares this degree of freedom, sigma, of this residual has to be zero. And in general, it's a very non-linear problem, so you need to solve to use some iterative technique. I will not do this. So as I showed, so you compute the boundary flux, then you distribute, then you gather. For example, this is P2. So for this vertex, you compute the sum of the contribution of each element. And if you are in the midpoint, you have just two elements in 2D. And that's it. So how this can be possible? So again, my problem. So I have a tessellation of the domain. And in fact, I need to define two types of residual, one for the internal element, and one for the boundary phase. For the internal domain, this is exactly what I said before. So I'm going to define these quantities which have satisfied this relation problem. And for the boundary phase, after some thought, you have a similar relation, except that this relation is replaced by this one. And you can interpret this as you take an element, then you shrink it into a triangle, you shrink it into an edge. And because of the opposite edge, give birth to this term, and the one which is really on the boundary, you use a numerical flux, and this is why you have this. So it's exactly the same thing. And then your scheme will be that for any degree of freedom, you have the sum of the element, which the internal element of the residual, and possibly if this degree of freedom is on the boundary, you have the sum of on the face element of the residual, which has to be zero. So I first need to define the structure conditions. So you want to converge to the correct weak solution. You want to have formal accuracy, monotonicity, and convergence. So conservation is quite easy. So again, I have my conservation property for the internal element and for the face element. And it's easy to see that if you have the assumption of the standard Lax-Vandroff theorem, which is written here, so something, a sequence which is bounded in infinity, and there is a subsequence which converges into some LP, so P equal 2 here, then you have, for sure, you are going to, the limit solution of this subsequence is going to be a weak solution of your problem. And I don't want to go too much into the proof, but the proof here is, in fact, this is the only proof of the method. So you take a test function, which is compactly supported, and then, because the scheme is the following, then you multiply by the value of the test function at the degree of freedom sigma, then you sum over all the possible degrees of sigma, then you switch the two sums, so instead of having a sum over the degrees of freedom, now you have a sum over the internal element and the face element of these quantities. And then the trick is to introduce the Galerkin residual, which is nothing more than the integral over the element of the Lagrange test function multiplied by the divergence, and using the Green formula you have this. And similar things for the face element, and I take this one. So this was your scheme before. Enfin, this is your scheme. And then you introduce the Galerkin residual by adding and subtracting, very standard technique. And because the role of introducing this Galerkin residual is that very easily you recover some weak variational form of your problem, and you need to have a rest, and the rest you need to control. And to control this rest, the remark is the following, that because the sum of the Galerkin residual is exactly the sum of the residual on each element, when you sum this on over all the degrees of freedom, because of the construction of the Galerkin residual, and again you use this thing. So this enables to transform these two sums into these sums. So the main difference is that before you had only one V sigma, and now you have a difference of V sigma. And the reason is that because for each element you add zero, and zero is a constant multiplied by the sum of the difference of the residual, and you choose correctly the constant, which are nothing more than these quantities. And then using this and standard the regularity of the mesh, standard weak PV estimate, etc., etc., it's not difficult to show that the subsequent which is converging to, in fact, converge to a weak solution of the problem. So I have done all this not for the fun, nor for the pleasure of showing formula, but because really this relation is the master relation of the problem, and it helps a lot to understand what accuracy means. So here you have an unstructured mesh, so you cannot do a Taylor expansion, like in finite difference. So you need to rely on a weak form of the truncation error, which is this one. So as classically, you plug into the formula some interpolant of the exact solution, if the exact solution is smooth enough, and you take the maximum over all the possible test function, bounded, and I left the norm quite vague. And what you look is for condition which guarantees that this relation exists, it's possible. And it's easy to show that if you have also some coercivity in the method, then you automatically, like it's exactly the same proof as for SUPG or discontinuous Galerkin, you are going to get this type of error estimate in this norm that I've left a little bit vague, and I will stay vague for the rest of my talk. For some reason I can explain if you want, but again you start from this relation, so I have forgotten the zero. And because of this relation, then you can rewrite the truncation error as a Galerkin term plus a rest. And again, here, this is the Galerkin residual. So you want to control these two terms. And the key remark is the following, that if you have a steady problem, then the Galerkin residual is not zero, of course, but it's over h to the k plus d. It's the same story. And the proof is the same. It's exactly the same, except that before, it's so much the same that I did a cut and paste, and I forgotten to remove the stabilization term. So remove this term, and it's exactly the same as the one I've done for SUPG. And because of this, playing with this formula, so you can easily show that this term is over h to k plus 1. And then, looking at the term, you can see easily that because this is over h to the k plus d, this is over h. Well, there is a finite number and bounded number of degrees of freedom in each element. That if the mesh is regular, there is over h to the minus d elements. Then you gather all the terms. And if you want that this is over h to the k plus d, you must impose that this quantity, the residual, will be over h to the k plus d. Because, again, it's a steady problem. So this is what I summarize here. So you have a truncation error of this form, provided that the residual behaves like this. And you have several examples, SUPG, with jump stabilization, DG, for example. Now, I want to enforce accuracy and also stability. So this is an idea which goes back to Phil Rowe, in fact. And at the time, they were just dealing with P1 element on triangles. This is why it's, this condition is it's called in their jargon linearity preserving scheme. So the remark is the same remark, in fact, is that the total residual, this integral of the normal flux, is over h to the k plus d. So if you want to that the residual has the same properties, the easiest way is to define the total residual as something proportional to the total residual with a proportionality coefficient which is uniformly bounded in space. For example, for P1, and if you do pure Galerkin, beta is 1/3, and if the scheme were stable, it would be the best scheme ever. Fortunately, it's not stable for us. So, and of course, there is a price to pay because there is the famous Godunov theorem saying that you cannot have the butter and the money of the butter without doing something. And the something is to introduce some sort of non-linearity in the business. And so, how do we do this? So, the solution method is a bit strange. Usually, when you have a TVD scheme, for example, you start from Lax van't Hoff. And you try to add dissipation. Here it's exactly the opposite. We start from a very dissipative scheme. I will show you an example right after. And then you introduce a kind of limiter, there is no better word, which produces a set of residuals that enables all the possible properties. And the example I take is a generalization of the Rosanov scheme. Or Lax-Friedrichs, local Lax-Friedrichs, which can be reformulated like this. So it's tuned by the total residual divided by the number of degrees of freedom in the element, plus a term which mimics a Laplacian on a graph, which is monitored by alpha, and alpha has to be large enough. And why? Because it's very cheap, it's very dissipative, and it's monotone, and it can be even more dissipative. You just have to increase this coefficient. And of course, this choice is not. There are plenty of choice, but this choice is very nice. Alors, so the construction is the following. You start, you are in any element, you construct the residual, the Rosanov residual, and we use what you call a limiter. So one example is this Struis limiter. So Robert Struis was a PhD student at VKI in 1991, and using a totally different approach, he ended up with this formula. So it looks a little bit like mean mode. So it's the positive part of the ratio of the Rosanov residual divided by the total residual, divided by some scaling parameter. And the scaling parameter can be shown to be always larger than one. So there is no never divide, zero divide problem, provided, of course, here there is no zero divide problem. So where does this formula come from? It's very simple to see. So the problem is that you have a set of low-order residuals, so think Rosanov, and you want to build a higher-order residual. Higher-order means it satisfies this scaling. So all the known schema can be revised like this. So it's a sum over, for any element, it's a sum over the difference between the value of u at sigma minus all the possible other value multiplied by a coefficient. And it's well known that if C sigma is positive, then you have a local maximum principle. And then you do a formal calculation. You add, you take this is the high order residual you want to have. You divide by the monotone one. You put this into the sum. This quantity is positive, so you just want to impose this to be positive. So you translate it in terms of the residual. It means that the product of the higher order multiplied by the lower order has to be positive. And it's better to divide by phi squared, the total residual squared, because it's also positive. And it's exactly the quantity you are needing. So because I'm a bit late. So you introduce the ratio for the monotone residual and the ratio for the higher order residual. What you want is that there's some B1, this is conservation. And for to preserve monotonicity, you just have this quantity, which you translate into this by saying that for all possible degrees of freedom in one element, their product has to be positive. And then accuracy means that this is bounded. This is a bit complicated, so just to show how it works geometrically, you take the example n equal to 3, so P1 approximation. So you have this lower order ratio, higher order ratio. You have there some B1, positive, etc. So you interpret this as a barycentric coordinate in some abstract plane. So you take points like this. And then the scheme is identified to a point. So you have a monotone, a higher, lower order point and a higher order point. And the problem is to find a mapping. So these are my three points. So you have this monotone scheme here, or here. And your problem is to have beta bounded. So I want beta between 0 and 1. So this is this triangle. And so your problem is to find a mapping between this part to that part, which has a property of keeping this product rule true, which means that you should not cross these lines, because these lines are the line for which beta 2 here is 0, here beta 1 is 0, and here beta 3 is 0. So you, if you are here, it means that you must go somewhere on this edge. If you are inside the triangle, you must stay in the triangle. If you are here, you must go somewhere here. And so one of the many formula is precisely the Rusanov technique, the Struis technique. Yeah, sorry. So fortunately or unfortunately, it's not exactly enough. You need to add a string lambda term, which is monitored by theta. And theta is, if theta is always one, then you spoil this infinity property. And fortunately, you can take theta when you have a local extrema and one when you have no local extrema. So this scheme satisfies everything. And the reason why you need to have this, you want to solve this and on the quad mesh, and on this mesh, the total residual, you need to initialize on the mesh, and on this, each of these elements, the total residual are zero. So this is the exact solution, and this is like a checkboard mode. In both cases, you have zero for the total residual, which means that if you don't have the red term here, then your initialization will be the final stage of your computation, which means that you have two solutions to your problem, and it's not possible. So you need to add additional dissipation. This additional dissipation should not kill your accuracy. This is why you need to be streamlined. And with this technique, it works very well. It works very well, for example, this is a solid rotation using Rusanov, so P1, and this is P2, and the mesh is this one. So it's not very coarse, but you get very good results. And you can increase the accuracy. So P1 is second order, P2 third order, P3 fourth order, etc., etc. Then you can also work with non-linear problems. So this is Burger. Imagine this is space and time. So it's Burger like this. In this solution, you have a fan which focuses on the shock. And this is P1 and P2, so you have no oscillation at all. So, in fact, the scheme is very simple to implement. You just make a loop over the element. Then, on each element, you construct the total residual. You evaluate Rusanov. You do this cooking technique. And then you gather, and that's it. So, it applies. Well, this I will skip. I wanted to show you that. You can these are for finite volume scheme, in fact, and it works very well. For example, on this multi-body problem, which is turbulent. Well, I've skipped how I describe I approximate the viscous term, and you can compare experimental and P2 P2 results, which are very good. And this problem is relatively complex. It works in 3D, so this is a delta wing problem, so you have vortices and the mesh is quite coarse, even though the Reynolds number is high, so it's turbulent. So what I've tried to do is to discuss how you can construct a high-order finite element-like method. So it's finite element-like because there are many possible variational formulation, but the funny thing is that the test or the variational formulation depend on the solution. So it's highly non-linear inside, so there is a little trick and some sort of magic. But everything is seen from the very discrete point of view, and this is why there is a difficulty in the analysis of this. But you can show that you have N infinity, you can have L2 stability, and while keeping formal higher order of accuracy, including at extrema. So this has been applied to compressible flow, turbulent shallow water, MHD, many problems. And for unsteady problem, we know how to do this for second order in time, and higher order it's in progress, but there are some ideas which are promising. And I've finished. If you do brute force, it means that you need to take, for example, SUPG. In SUPG, you need to multiply the problem, the UDT plus lambda nabla u equal 0, by the test function, and then you have a mass matrix, which is, there is a mass matrix, and you want to avoid the mass matrix. Because it's a mass matrix, you need to invert it. SUPG is not really a problem, but here the mass matrix is going to depend on the solution. And there is no real reason to be convinced that this form of the mass matrix, because there is no clear variational formulation, will be invertible. So the idea is to cheat a little bit, to add and subtract a term formally, and then to approximate one of the terms without violating accuracy, etc., etc. And then you can do mass ramping. Well, in a nutshell, it means that you have your highly nonlinear system and you do a defect correction technique. And this can be interpreted as a two-step defect correction technique or Runge-Kutta. Well, it's a bit technical, but. It works well. And the only thing I could not show because of time and too slow, is that all this, you can define a numerical flux. And in fact, this formulation also works for any continuous finite element. And then, it will be in the proceeding, I have an explicit formulation for the flux. And the only thing you have to pay is that in a standard flux, you take an edge, you have two states, and you have and then you have to introduce several states, and the states are the ones which are in this element. But you keep this local conservation property. So I don't know if it's useful for the analysis, but at least it's useful to convince engineers that a continuous finite element is really locally conservative with a flux that you can really show them.
Okay. Now, finally, you know, on behalf of the local organizer, we present small gift.